nice. You never know if it could change your life. Take a chance, you're neither wrong or right. You never know if you don't roll.
Hello, Matt.
Howdy, Rob.
It's another beautiful day in the kingdom of gaming that we live in. The beautiful,
hold that out there.
TTRPG verse that we exist. The franchise, the extended role playing universe.
It's a nice kingdom. Divided into fiefs, each held by a dungeon master. Under each fief is somewhere between 2 to 8 players.
And this system is the most perfect, divinely ordained system that has ever existed, and it cannot be improved upon. It is the perfect division of both labor, hierarchy, understanding of social relations.
Right, yeah, everyone knows their place.
Exactly.
But I guess the question is, in the kingdom of gaming, Where do we fit in, Rob?
Where do we fit in?
Are we the church?
We're the lowest of all. We're traveling minstrels.
We're outside the thing.
We exist outside of the social order. The church hates us. The people enjoy us, but cannot be seen to associate with us because we are low and base, as socially unacceptable as criminals.
Right.
Essentially,
we're the actors of the medieval time. Yeah,
precisely.
Okay. Sure.
Hello, everyone. This is Dungeon Master of None.
I'm Dungeon Master Matt.
I'm Dungeon Master Rob. And from our vantage point on the outside of town, where people are hurling tomatoes at us,
I'm in one of those little wooden things. It's really exciting.
We're pilloried because we stayed too long, and the magistrate disliked our. The way that we spoke.
They're throwing lettuce. There's just like basically an entire salad.
Just covered in rotten fruits and vegetables. Yeah, and today we're going to be answering some mail, which builds up. Thank you all for writing to us. We're sorry that we don't get to it very consistently, but we like when you send us mail, so please continue to do so, and we will hopefully answer it as we have time. So, yeah, time to answer some listener mail.
Excellent. Let's get into it. Here's our first letter, Rob, and it's a let's start off with something like this is a no fun letter in that
That's right.
It is about some of the most important parts of running a game, but there's not a lot of jokes we can make on. So just put your joke hat down.
We'll see about that. But yeah.
If you can put your joke hat down for 5 seconds.
Just
give me 5 seconds.
Just take this seriously, all right?
Yeah,
let's just take it seriously for once. Can you just be serious for once in your life?
Yeah.
No, I can't.
Hey, Matt and Rob, I'm a huge fan of all your content. As a longtime player and first-time DM, it's proven very helpful. I was wondering if you've considered putting out an episode on basic note organization. I heard a lot on what makes a good story arc, but a very little idea on how to actually organize my thoughts so I can run a game without flipping around too much. I'm using Cyrid's 5e SRD on OneNote, which honestly, you could do an episode of your podcast on. It's brilliant and polished. You can find the latest version on Reddit. Anyway, thanks for all you do. Oh, right. I forgot to mention I'm doing a homebrew setting and plot, hence the need for organization. Right now, I have a Google Doc with a bunch of narrative describing cultures, political movements, etc. But how do I organize things to actually run sessions? I think it would make a great episode. Let me know what you think. Thanks, guys. Kevin.
Kevin, this is a great question. I appreciate you writing it. I want to be real upfront about this. I have ADHD, and my note-taking is I throw notes at whatever notebook or program is open at the time that I am thinking of them. And then someday, if I'm lucky, I take all of those assorted notes.
You can actually find them, yes.
And collate them into something coherent. So I'm actually, like, I'm taking a look at this OneNote SRD, and it looks awesome. It looks like it's got tabs and all sorts of things.
I have to spend, like, a good 10% of my day on OneNote of my, like, working day. So I cannot, right? There's, like, a reaction to it that makes me angry.
This is how I feel
about it. It does look very beautiful.
It looks very pretty. This is how I feel about Google Docs, which I use for a lot of things, but I have to use so much for work. So I use, theoretically, I use Evernote to organize my D&D, and I also use a lot of paper notebooks specifically for my role-playing games. I guess what I'm trying to say here is I don't know that you should take note-taking advice from me. I would like to maybe do an episode on this with Matt, because Matt's more organized than I am, but both of us, I think, have a... Well, correct me if I'm wrong. It's a little ad hoc, I guess. I mean, I use a bunch of different systems because of the necessity of doing... Sorry, side tangent. I feel like once we're... Because we've been hybrid for, you know, a year now. Sometimes I'm online, sometimes I'm in person. I have a bunch of things everywhere. And once I'm committed to one gaming form factor, once I guess commit probably to being in person in perpetuity, my note taking will change. But right now I have just kind of been putting things wherever, because for the better part of a year, I was entirely online, and so I was using Evernote or Google Docs, but I've been a little bit in person, and so I've been using my physical notebooks again. This is a great question, and sorry, I've been rambling a bunch because it's core to my heart, and I haven't come with, like, a good answer to this yet.
I don't know if there is a good answer, but I can speak, I guess, like, whatever system you're using, right? I think there are some ways of, like, just basic organization. We could get into this more, but, like, for me, like, there could be a page on, like you mentioned, political movements, cultures, cosmology. But, like, I always like to have one page before the session. Like, when I'm doing my prep for that session, I'm like, here's what I need to remember for this session. And then I'll have, like, a page that's, like, mid-level organization. Like, okay, here's a page for an arc, right? And that could be a page in OneNote or Evernote or Google Documents. For me, I like to, like, write it out with a pencil and my hand and keep it in a binder. And, you know, I'll have, like, a couple Google Documents to supplement that binder. And if they're ever in a place I like them, I'll print them off. I like having a physical binder. A page for the next session, you know, a section, a tab for recaps of what, like, the players are doing, a tab for, you know, overall plots, tab for world building. That's how I do it.
I mean, this is one of the things that I would love to have, like, more than anything in the world, and is one of my, like, greatest anxieties as a person who lives in the 21st century, not just about role-playing games, but everything. I would love to have all... I'm a huge note taker. I take notes on books I want to read, ideas I have, work stuff, RPG stuff. You know, I have, like, all of this, like, ideas floating around. And I, because of the limitations of, or the structured limitations of technology, basically, it's all... Some of it's in my email, some of it's on Google Docs, some of it's on Evernote, some of it's, you know, wherever, some of it's in my note app on my phone. And so I fantasize. Yeah,
there's a lot that gets put into that note app on the phone, because you're like, ah, here's an idea. There's nothing else to write down with besides this.
And I fantasize about being able to all, like, put this all into, like, one place. And I have yet, like, I keep being stymied by just the way that the world works. Like, I'm out and I have my phone, or I don't have my phone and I have a piece of paper, or I am just, like, punching things into the, you know, the search bar and favoriting it, you know. So, Kevin, this is a great suggestion. And maybe, Matt, you and I should actually do an episode on this now that I've talked about it, because maybe that might inspire me to actually, like, really try to nail this down. I want to say this is a challenge.
We don't have an answer. Listen to me, not Rob, for the basic advice. Create one page for your next session and then have your other stuff. But we'll talk about it more.
We'll talk about it more. And it really depends on the session. I usually have what Matt described, like, this is what's happening today. It's just all of my supplemental notes are scattered to the winds. But excellent question, Kevin.
Thank you, Kevin.
All right, our next question is about playtesting. Hello, DMs Matt and Rob. With some of the custom enemies and NPCs I'm making for my setting guide, I've realized that some playtesting might be in order. However, I'm not sure how to go about doing this. What should I look out for in fights with these monsters? Should I try to run the monsters in different scenarios and combinations? different party sizes and levels, or should I run them against parties of the level I want them to be a match for? These are the questions that immediately come to mind, but any and all advice on the subject is welcome. I always appreciate what you do. Thanks again, Chelsea, Chiratsu on Patreon. Thank you, Chelsea.
Oh, thank you, and thanks for the support. This is a good question, especially if you're like creating something for publication. I have, I think, a short answer, right? If you're playtesting something for publication, I'm not sure about for a setting guide. I've never published one of those before.
I have a short answer for this too, Matt.
I have like playtested stuff for like, let's say, a con game or one of the modules we have written, right?
Yeah.
And for that, like, I mean, I think just the act of playtesting itself should be enough. Your instinct of like, should I playtest it against parties of the level I want them to be a match for? Yes.
So this is a good, this is a interesting question, because when it's a little different for a monster. When playtesting an adventure, which is what Matt and I have, I think, the most experience on in both directions, you just want to run it as many times as possible to get as much experience and feedback. With a monster, it's interesting because you want it to be appropriate and balanced. And the problem with 5th edition, which we've talked about a bunch, is that it's really, CR is just like a very like poor measure. And
then on top of that, there's no such thing as playtesting a monster, right? You're playtesting an encounter. Like, monsters don't exist in a vacuum.
That's exactly what my advice here, Chelsea, is that I would design, again, assuming you have players who are cooperative or time to do this, I would design maybe two to three different real play encounters where you would put this monster, and then run parties through that as many times as you possibly can. Like, I guess it, I mean, once or twice is fine, but like, if you're trying to be perfect, like, this is to me the best way to test a monster. Put it in an actual encounter and then have players run through that encounter and see how it goes.
And the things you're looking for during that is especially so, like, you know, oh, okay, balance, right? Like, this ability, like, wiped everyone out.
Right.
I gave the monster an ability that, like, paralyzed everyone for 2 rounds. That was a bad idea.
This DC is too high, and everybody breathed right. The, you know, toxic smoke and died. Not good.
But it's also, like, especially for publication, you should be looking for clarity, right? Mm-hmm. Like, did this make sense? Did I write this in a way that, like... everyone can understand what this monster's abilities are. And then the most important thing with playtesting is to, like, stop and get feedback, right? Mm-hmm. That's why I think playtesting a role-playing game is the same as playing a role-playing game, except you might be stopping in the middle of an adventure, in the middle of an encounter, or at the very least at the end and saying, okay, let's go around. What was confusing? What made sense? What was fun? Etc. Right?
Right.
And getting that immediate feedback. Because no one's going to want to write this up later, right? No one has time to do that. So
the things you're looking for is, like, obviously, is it too difficult? Is it too easy? Is it a fun monster to fight, right? Like, you know, even if it doesn't murder the players or they don't easily crush it, you know, is it annoying? Is it difficult? Is it frustrating? And, yeah, just get that feedback. I think that... really, like, trying to create a realistic scenario in which you would encounter that monster is going to give you more actionable information than anything else.
Right. And I think your instinct, your other instinct of, like, oh, I need to try it against different party sizes and levels and stuff like that. I mean, that's a good instinct, but it's just impossible, right?
Yeah.
I mean, there are too many combinations, right? You're like, Dungeons & Dragons were basically, like, at... chess level complexity. Like, there's more combinations of parties and encounters and possibilities than there are atoms in the universe. So just run it against a party, right?
Yeah.
As long as that party isn't something weird, like, oh, we're playtesting an undead monster against 6 clerics, all with the turn undead emphasis.
Right.
No. Yeah. Yeah. Thanks for the question, Chelsea. Good luck. Hi, guys. Thank you for your podcast. I stumbled into it back when you were dunking on the McElroys, but ended up sticking around for your insightful, insightful commentary, useful advice, and positive chemistry. On to the question. I'll be taking over my group's biweekly game in the fall following the end of a three-year-old campaign this summer. One of the situations the table has enjoyed over the past few years is when our characters get some vague authority, especially when that authority comes with a badge. So when I take over, I've pitched the game as being focused on a squad of rural fantasy cops, and the rest of the table seems to be into it. Basic question, do you have any advice on running a group of cops in a fantasy setting? More than how do mysteries exist in the world of magic, I'm curious how you would approach this setup and what sources, historical or fictional, you'd mine for inspiration. We'd be playing in the Dale Lands and the Forgotten Realms, so I've been delving into folktales from the UK, British murder mysteries, and of course, Hot Fuzz.
Hot Fuzz. I love it. That's it.
Have you ever fired your gun into the air because you're so overcome with emotion?
Dramatically so overcome with, yeah. This is a great question, Drew. So I want to first say that while we all know that ACAB, it is...
Right, that's Drew's second question. We'll get to that in a second.
We'll get to that in a second. To answer your question, I mean, I think that there is no greater body of work than the police procedural. Nobody get mad at me for this, but there's probably more police procedural television shows and cop novels than, you know.
Oh, really? Name five.
Law and Order, Law and Order SVU, Law and Order SVU Miami, CSI Miami, CSI, CSI Las Vegas, CSI. Sorry,
you're gonna say CSI New Jersey? Where were you going with that? yeah, okay. There's a lot of these.
Yeah, no. I mean, you know, there's the point I'm making is that you could do a lot worse for any game than just modeling it off of a police procedural.
Right, and also, like, don't forget that if you've added fantasy to cops. Like, you know, you've got, like, basically Buffy the Vampire Slayer, right, and everything that's like that, you know, supernatural. You've got Monster of the Week, right?
Exactly.
Which is a great role-playing game that you should maybe read.
You should look into. It's also a great just model for running games if you prefer an episodic game, you know. And we talked about this last week or 2 weeks ago with Harry Potter and the fantasy school. Everybody gets what you're doing, right? So if you're like, you're cops, you're solving mysteries, you know, you're the hot one and you have chemistry with the other hot one. I mean, just, you know, everyone knows what's happening in the game. So that makes it really easy for your players to fall into their roles and have a good time. There are upsides and downsides to this, like we talked about with the magical school, but the upside is that you don't have to do a lot of world building. You can just sort of like set the general stage and everyone just sort of gets how to play.
My advice is start off with five sessions at least of just pure episodic Monster of the Week. And then if you've decided, all right, this is how this game is working, I have some vague ideas of where I want to take maybe a bigger overall plot, then you can do that. Because that's how all those, like, you know, procedural shows work, right? Some of them introduce a bigger thing later. So I should probably get to Drew's advanced question here.
Yeah, this
advanced
is another good
D&D
question.
Do you have any advice on running a group of ethical cops in a fantasy setting? The more I look into things, the more murky they become. I've yet to find a police organization that does not have some pretty dark worms writhing around its roots. From the Mounties handed oppressing indigenous peoples to Texas Rangers brutalizing Mexicans to Interpol's Nazi phase, these organizations
seem to... I didn't
know
about that one. Thanks, Drew. I can't wait to look that up.
seem to form around the protection of three P's: property, privilege, and power. I do not want this to be the focus of our game. The law aspect of things is an easy way to get into the action, to get players clear goals, and to facilitate play, so I don't want to get rid of it, but I do want to be mindful of its history. Thanks so much for taking the time to read this. Interested in hearing your thoughts on an eventual episode. Drew.
Drew, another great question. And yes, like we all know, ACAB, how do I want to say this? I don't want to encourage people just sort of ignoring the unpleasant roots of things, even in gameplay, even in fantasy, even in storytelling, right? There's been some talk. There was a great article, Matt, I don't know if you read this, about the how so many popular board games are extremely, like, colonialist, like Puerto Rico and Settlers of Catan and all
right.
of these.
Right, I heard Puerto Rico was going to, like, come up with a new, like, gloss for
this and
its
other
game,
ones are
going
to rebrand because they're very much like oppress the natives and get rich. So,
oh, man, was the archipelago?
Yeah.
Fucking just awful, right? Interesting game design, but oh, man.
Yeah, off topic. But if you're looking for a inversion of this, that's actually a really, really fun game. Spirit Island is a game where you play as the indigenous sort of gods of an island and fight off colonizers. It rules. It's a lot of fun. It's a very hard game. Anyway, the point I'm trying to make here is that I don't want you to just, like, ignore the complicated roots of policing and of cops. However, in your fantasy game, you can dodge this. You can say, you could just be a perfectly wholesome organization of law officers in a rural, you know, fantasy world. And yes, structurally, you are still a protector of the three P's, but you don't necessarily have to be part of a, you know, long tradition of oppressing people. It'll still be there, but you can just have fun. That's part one. You can just do
part
that.
One. Yeah. And I would say a next step is, like, if you're thinking more about this, I've tried this in my own game, is since you haven't started the game yet, is you could work with your players to come up with, all right, we're doing character creation today, but we're also doing an organization creation, right? And you could work with them to come up with, like, the organization that they represent that maybe in our fantasy game doesn't have, like, these dark roots, right? Or if they do, they might be something that the players are going to investigate, confront, and deconstruct, right? So from my own experience, I ran a game for a long time about, witchers who were socialists, right? Who basically served the people of a poor but slightly utopian socialist collection of villages, right? And I helped my players sat down with me and helped work through what, you know, the bounds of that organization would be, right?
And I played in this game and it was great. It was a lot of fun. And this was the recommendation that I was going to make, is that when you think about what's fun about a police procedural, about playing as a cop, the function, the theoretical function of law enforcement, protecting people, solving crimes, that sort of thing, doesn't have to be attached to a badge or an organization or a city watch or whatever. In real life, there's lots of examples of this. Community defense organizations, unions sometimes serve this purpose in American history. So if you want to just completely avoid the cop issue and play the exact type of game, they can be members of a community defense organization. They can be, you know, union enforcers. That kind of sounds a little bit like, but you know what I mean? You know, they could be members of an organization who solve crimes and help people, but
right
from the ground up.
You think of, you know, the Witchers or the Watchers from Buffy the Vampire Slayer, right? That you have to ask yourself, okay, why does the police procedural make, like, writing television episodes so easy? And I will add, playing a, like, Monster of the Week game so easy. It's because it lubricates, like, gameplay, right? Mm-hmm. It gives players a clear purpose. There's a problem we need to solve. There's werewolves killing the peasants or whatever. Mm-hmm. And then it gives everyone, like, an easy reason to, like, want to talk to you. Right?
Right.
This is why a game like Dogs in the Vineyard works so well. But it's also why the creator of Dogs in the Vineyard, D. Vincent Baker, stopped publishing it because of the bad implications of, like, this sort of pseudo-religious law enforcement agency. So All you need is the reason why people want to talk to you, right? And they don't have to be cops, right? Maybe you're rangers, right? There's the idea of in the Dale lands, maybe the term ranger isn't just a class. It's people who protect, right?
Right.
And people recognize you as people who are going to do the right thing. And one of the fun things you can add to the game is let your players decide what should happen to those who transgress, right? Mm-hmm. Leave their authority open-ended. They don't have to, like, you know, issue the death penalty to everyone who has committed a fantasy crime, right?
Right.
Maybe they can come up with a better solution.
Well, right. And if you if the players don't have the power to imprison or to kill, I guess with impunity, they'll probably have to kill somebody. It's Dungeons and Dragons. That, you know, also avoids some of the, you know, if you, Matt made a good point here, right? Like, people, in order for this to work, like, people have to have trust, they have to respect the authority, right? Why are they going to talk to them? Why are they going to work with them to solve these crimes or answer these questions? And that doesn't necessarily have to be because they are armed and bebadged officers of the law, right? Think about, Matt mentioned, yeah, the Watchers from Buffy the Vampire Slayer. They could be, you could have them be private detectives or something. There's all sorts of ways to model that exact sort of game without the law enforcement gloss. And I think that's
I like your union idea a lot, because it's like, oh, the Dale lands are a lot of like small villages, right? They're mm-hmm. kind of sometimes out on their own, and it's like, oh yeah, well, they you know, they'll give you free food and lodging for the night because they know that your organization that your player characters are a part of will help them, you know, kill the wyverns that are nesting in the
right.
trees nearby, or, you know, remove a curse.
Mm-hmm. So that's how I would do it. But you can also, again, Columbo, he's a good cop. Mulder and Scully.
The only one.
I'd say Mulder and Scully are a gray area. But, you know, these are both like, you know, cop-ish
just
shows.
One more investigation, one more check, yeah. Man.
Speaking of, like, you know, UK British murder mysteries, Father Brown, right. he's not really a cop, but, you know, he solves crimes. I'm just saying, there's ways to do this that you know, avoid the issue. It is a complicated one, and I'm glad you're being thoughtful about it, but it's a fun, there's a reason why people like cop shows, and it's not necessarily because they're about cops. It's just sort of a story framework that we all find familiar and enjoy, and there's ways to capture that feeling and that and borrow that framework without glorifying police. You have to do a little extra work, but I think you're already halfway there.
I think, I mean, listen, we're not asking you to imagine, okay, what would a world without police look like, which is something we should all try to figure out. But, you know, maybe you could do a little bit of that, right? Okay, what would a world without police look like where there are still dragons and necromancers?
And I really, really do not want to overemphasize the role of games or fantasy or anything, but I do believe that there is an important role to play in the stories that we tell, where we imagine a better world, right? And one, like Matt just said, without cops. So even though it's a little bit trickier than using, you know, the existing frameworks, I think that's both fun and interesting and potentially a teensy bit of social value.
Are there cops in Lord of the Rings? I guess there's the bounders of the Shire, but there's the rangers.
There's the bounders, there's the rangers. There's a lot of soldiers. You know, law enforcement works in the Shire. I'm not clear how law enforcement works in, like, Rohan or Gondor. It's a good question.
Yeah. There's definitely no cops in... There are no cops in Rohan, right?
Yeah, definitely.
We know this.
Rohan is a libertarian paradise.
Right. They're basically, you know, just, like, writing poems about their horses all day. There's a bunch of horse girls. And they're loving it. Good for them.
They love it.
No. Yeah, I mean, I think imagine the Shire, but everyone liked the Rangers.
Right. Yeah.
Now, I want to bring this up just very briefly is last year, in 2020, at the height of the nationwide protests against policing and against police brutality, Pathfinder released an adventure path called Agents of Edgewatch. Which,
unfortunate timing. I generally give Paizo a pass because I think they try. But yeah, this
they
was...
They try, but I mean, I think
real
they...
Bad.
They clearly recognized, basically, like, after they had already published it, that the or had it all written, that a lot of the cop tropes they leaned on in the adventure path were definitely not helpful, and, you know, a little harmful. Mm-hmm. They put out a statement on that. So I guess if you're interested in some of the wrong ways to do it, but like where there's maybe a recognition of some of the things that were still interesting, you could check out Agents of Edgewatch. I read through the first one, was not that interested. So, but you know, there's a
yeah,
cop.
Thing. I like Monster of the Week. They tried to do their best. This was trying to salvage a bad situation. So I think there's a lot to learn from that. I agree with Matt there. Yeah.
In my game of Monster of the Week, we tried to come up with a good cop organization, and we decided that we would be police for the Postal Service.
This is great.
Yeah. So, okay. Thanks for the thoughtful letter.
Drew, that was a really great question. Thanks so much. All right. Our next one. I found your podcast when looking for tools to help me become a better DM about 3 or 4 months ago. I started with episode 1 and have almost caught up. Welcome. Thanks. I have a question about DMing for neurodivergent players. I'm currently DMing the Lost Mine of Phandelver on roll 20 for a group of 4 players. One of my players, when she's not actively participating, has a tendency to step away from the computer and do something else, e.g. start cleaning up or playing with her dogs. We then have to wait for her to return when she needs to act. I spoke to her privately after the session, and I asked her if anything was wrong, if she wasn't enjoying the session, and if there's anything I could do to keep her in the game. I'm a relatively new DM. I've been DMing for less than a year, so I'm happy to take criticism from my players. She said she was having fun, but her ADHD makes it difficult for her to concentrate and focus on the game when she's not actively participating. Is there any way I can make her more involved in the game without taking the spotlight away from other players, or do I just accept that this is something she's going to work on and work around it? I've learned so much from your podcast already and hope to keep learning. Keep rolling them dice, Andrew.
Oh, wow. Great question.
This is a really good question, Andrew. And I already said it once this podcast, and, you know, I'll say it again. Like, I have ADHD and I manage it pretty well. And I have for most of my life. I'm medicated for it. I've realized in recent years that I think I DM, or I like to DM, because I have ADHD. It means there's less downtime and less opportunity for me to get distracted. So this isn't a solution for you. I'm just letting you know that I am aware of the challenges here. I DM for a couple of different groups, and one of them's a group of children, I think all of whom are neurodivergent in one way or another, including one girl who has very bad ADHD and does exactly what you just described, walk away from the table whenever it's not her turn. And what you've done is perfect. I was really impressed to read what you did, because this is exactly how I approach it at my games.
I think we should take credit for this, because if we said anything ever, it's always like just talk to your
just
player,
talk to your players.
One-armed player, and find out. And you did that, so thank you.
And you did that. And I know this is a little frustrating, but frankly, I don't know that there's anything else you can do. You've asked her if she's having fun. She says yes, but I get distracted. Check in with the other players. Make sure that it's not affecting their game experience. Maybe let her know that if she's not around for her turn, you might skip it. But if she's having fun and she's willing to work on it, then I think that this is a pretty acceptable solution. You know, I have a lot of players who get distracted who aren't neurodivergent. And if this is the only sort of impact that she's not always around to take her turn, that's an annoyance, but it's something you can work with. And, you know, you've checked in. She's trying to work with this particular limitation. I think you're doing a great job. And this is frankly how I would approach it. You know, It can be challenging, but especially with neurodivergent players, just as long as you're checking, you're saying, are you having fun? Is there anything I can do? You know, keep checking in. Maybe there'll be something that there is that you can do. You know, I like to address, I mean, this is, we've already said this, but like, I just make sure to address all of my players by either character name or by their names, whatever they're more likely to respond to, frequently, just to keep them engaged and make sure right. that they're paying attention. But that's not like a, it's not like a fix. It's just like, right. You know, a maintenance thing to keep them, you know, involved.
I think I would second Rob, like that. Yeah, there's not like another thing that you should do. I would say, and Rob, maybe feel free to disagree. You could look at the sort of system and structure of your game, right? There are two things that just reading your letters stick out to me as sort of causing structural problems, like making this more of a problem. Because this isn't really a problem. Like everyone, you know, has people who don't want to sit in front of a computer for a long amount of time, right? And that's your first point, right? It's an online game as opposed to an in-person game. So
yeah,
right,
and if there's nothing you can do about this, that's
there's nothing you can do about that.
Gonna be
and
problem.
The other one is D&D itself, right? It sounds like, you know, the thing is when it's not this player's turn, right? And so thinking about the last time, you know, do you have this problem when you're not in turns, right? When you're playing that part of the game where everything is sort of free-flowing, right? And everyone's doing something, and it's not one player's turn, right? Does this player still have that problem? And so cutting down, I mean, if you're playing Dungeons & Dragons, you can't get away, there are some systems that get away from this, of the idea of turns. Maybe thinking about cutting down the number of times per session that you're stuck in initiative order and turns mm-hmm. can be helpful.
And this is something I do in all of my games because neurodivergent or not, this is where I lose players, not permanently, but like their focus and their attention is I do like to use maps and minis, but I limit that because setting that up is a great time for players to start looking at their phones or start chatting or wander mm-hmm. away. I also tend to, if it's the same scene, use the same initiative order so that I can just jump into combat and be like, great, it's your turn. What happens? You know, I use Theater of the Mind a lot with my players that I know are going to get distracted. This is not a perfect fix, but again, as someone with ADHD who runs for people who also have ADHD, it helps maintain their attention. It helps maintain my attention. You know, there's little things you can do here and there. Also, like Matt said, it may be better with a different system, maybe better with a different module. Lost Minds of Phandelver is fun, but it's very structured D&D, and there's a lot of There's a lot of combats. So
the other thing I was like, Rob, do you think this is a good idea? I actually honestly have no idea, but just something I was thinking of is, like, if you're playing in Roll 20, is it fine to ask this player to, like, create a system where, like, if I'm getting up for 5 minutes to go clean or play with my dog, to put a message in chat, right? Like, be right back.
Yeah.
Right?
I think that's
because I know some of the times, like, it's shocking if, like, not everyone's paying attention. It's like, and it's this person's turn, and they're not there. Ah, right? And that way you can avoid that.
I would ask, and if they're comfortable with it, I think that's fine. And if, you know, if everyone's okay to work with it and nobody's feelings are hurt because she's wandering away and, like, you want to, like, message her or something or send her a text whenever it's her turn to act, I mean, that's not ideal, but, like, you're playing online and everybody's just trying to make it work, I think that's okay. Ask and see if that's an option. I agree.
Again, it seems like it's coming back to, like, turns things, so maybe a different initiative system, like a popcorn initiative where someone passes it to someone else, and that way it never comes up as this player's turn, you know, when they're not there, when she's not there, right? And that way, you know, when you see that, oh, she's back and seeing her thing, passing the turn to you.
That's a good, I think that might be worth trying if you continue to have trouble.
The other system thing is, like, see if the player is comfortable, like, putting the game on a speaker. So if they're getting up and walking around the room, it's not like they've taken their headphones out and they can, you know, hear what's going on. Because, you know, Nothing sounds better than me when it's not my turn, like playing fetch or tug of war with my dog while listening. That actually sounds great.
That sounds fun.
I would love to do that instead of just sitting
watching. And like I frankly, like sometimes when playing online, if I have speakers, I will do laundry, but I'm listening, I'm paying attention. It's just like it's helpful to sometimes do two things at once. So ask her if that's an option, or having Bluetooth on her speakers. Hopefully this is helpful. Andrew, it sounds like you've done a really good job of this already.
Great asking, like, hey, I'm open to criticism. Just let me know what you need, right? And, you know, they'll let you know.
Yeah. I hope this is
helpful.
Well
done, Andrew.
Yeah, well done.
Here's a quick letter on magic schools. Great episode on magic schools. The example for me is the principalities of Galantry from the OD&D setting of Mystara. Galantry setting had a magic school, but the whole country is split along magic schools. I think the same as the Pathfinder example you gave, lines. Each principality specializes in a different type of magic. Lots of politics and intrigue, with the magic school campaign being only one of several ideas given. I ran a solo campaign, me and one other player, set there, and the player character was a wizard from a rival wizard-ruled empire overseas who had enrolled in the school as a spy, Cold War style, on the research to research the faculty there. Paul.
I'm not familiar with this one, but this is a great idea. And I, like I said in the Magic Schools episode, I think you should just like lean in to the, just like really like, yeah, have whole principalities, whole countries, whole, you know.
Yeah. You've given purpose to this magic school.
Exactly.
As for your players. Well, one day, maybe we will dive into the old school Mystara setting, but today is not the day. Thanks for the letter, Paul.
Here's a follow-up from one of our recent episodes. Hello. This is in response to the question from Amelia regarding summoning animals being too good in your last episode. I really like summoning stuff as an archetype, so I just had a few things I wanted to add. When you summon something in the middle of combat, the thing you summon also has to roll initiative. I find that most people house rule that summoned animals act on the same round as the caster, which kind of messes up the balance of some of those spells and makes them seem better than they are.
True.
I want to admit here that I didn't know this. I thought that, isn't this how this worked in Pathfinder in 3.5? Like, they would act immediately as soon as you summoned them?
I think so, but in 5th edition, all the spells clearly say the animal rolls initiative and acts on its own initiative count.
So that's one thing, and that's also on me for not knowing that rule. I strongly discourage summoning for the reasons we talked about in that episode.
These are the conjurer spells. The conjurer spells do this.
Right. I find that most people house rule that summoned animals act on the same round as the caster, which kind of messes up the balance of some of those spells and makes them seem better than they are. This is accurate. If the animals can't act until potentially the next round of combat, then that does definitely like limit their effectiveness. Additionally, I would like to recommend the summon beast spell from Tasha's Cauldron of Everything to Amelia and anybody else having this problem with conjuring. The summon spells from Tasha's Cauldron of Everything are a fixed version of the conjure spells. And work with the 5e rules better. Did we mention this in our episode? They are much better.
We did. They're much more streamlined. Kyle, who this letter is from, is absolutely right.
Yeah. Summoning is Kyle. Kyle, thank you. You're absolutely right. This is a great point. Again, we came up with a lot of solutions in that episode. I hate to like take things away from players, but you can always just say, please use summon beast instead of conjure animals because it's better balanced. And hopefully your player that loves to summon will still be happy and it's balanced and won't break.
It's got the stats right there in the spell. Yeah, it works better. Those Tasha spells,
those
really
are really
nice.
Good. They're much better. Here's another one.
Oh, ooh, yeah, go for it.
Thank you, everyone who wrote in about this. I appreciate your feedback. We're not, like, we know the rules. We're not experts. So if you know something that we don't, we are happy to add an update. Eric writes, hey guys, great response to the conjure animal spell question, but something I thought you might pick up on and is a pretty big factor, they don't need to be the same beasts, they just need to be that CR or lower. So it really is on the DM to pick appropriate animals for the environment. For instance, in a forest it could be one giant owl, two wolves, three giant rats, a boar, and a cat. This actually adds a ton of fun and whimsy to the game. You can even create a list and have the PC roll for each. Eric. Good point that I had not considered.
We definitely assumed that it was always going to be the same thing, and it is not, right? So, yeah, everyone runs these spells wrong, which is why they redid them in Tasha's, and thankfully they're much better.
I tend to, you know, I don't want to criticize too much because, you know, it's just not fun or helpful, but like, these spells are a mess. The conjure animal spell, conjure spells, they're a catastrophe. The fact that so many
conjure
people,
animals is a mess.
It's terrible.
he summoned it like a dog.
Summoned a dog. Anyway, the point is, we now have better versions that like actually allow you to summon things well and interestingly, and that work with the game. Where possible, use those. The fact that so many people can read these spells and either come to different interpretations or use them wrong is an indication that they are not well designed.
Excellent. Thanks for the letters, everyone. Here's a nice letter that's from Sally. Hey, Rob and Matt. Long time, third time. I was recently on a long drive with my partner who does not play TTRPGs, and while she supports my interests and hobbies, generally isn't interested in TTRPG-related content. While we were taking a break from the audiobook we were listening to, Empire of Pain, The Secret History of the Sackler Dynasty by Patrick Radden Keefe, highly recommend it, and she said, what to listen to next, driver's choice. I was the driver, so I put on episode 173 of DM of None, Railroading. I've never seen her so interested in TTRPG-related conversations, including the ones I have had with her. She laughed, she learned, she found the episode, and you too, totally engaging and informative. A few days later, I told her I was going to do some prep for an upcoming session of a game I'm running, and she said, beaming, quoting Sly Flourish via DM of None, because, quote, you build worlds, not stories, right? It ruled and was a great moment. Related, I am finally running my first ever 5e campaign, and it's homebrew. Couldn't have done it without your tips and guidance, and also your encouragement via your anyone can GM, go get them, have fun, stance on GMing. Thanks for the podcast, and also reading my DMs on Twitter about certain things and subreddits, etc. Sally.
Thanks so much, Sally. Friend of the show. I'm so glad to hear that. I'm glad that it was interesting and informative, and that was the takeaway. You want to tell stories, right? But you're building the world, and that's just right. Like that's how you think about it. And the more as a DM you can,
you build worlds so that you can tell.
So stories. You can tell stories exactly. Right.
You don't build a story so that you can have a world.
Exactly. I'm so glad to hear that.
Yeah, thank you. My wife is also reading A Secret History of the Sackler Dynasty, and it's like every 10 minutes, like, did you know the Sacklers also invented, like, Valium? Do you know that, like, the Sacklers also, like, have the largest collection of, like, Chinese art in the world? I'm like, stop it. There's too many, like, crazy things.
Oh, man. Okay. Thanks again, Sally.
Thanks, Sally.
Here's another one. Hello, Matt and Rob, I would like to first off, thank you for your awesome podcast. You do a great job of discussing a little bit of anything and everything related to TTRPGs and give great content oriented toward D&D. I would like to note something I have noticed a few times. I recently listened to your episode 160, 25 resources for Dungeon Masters, and I believe it was about minute 32 of this episode when there was a joke made referring to the Bible. Now, I was hesitant to reach out to you gentlemen about this, as I do not want to come across in the wrong way. However, I believe I've heard similar things in the past on this podcast. The reason I was frustrated to hear the Holy Bible referred to as a joking answer to if you are confused about a rule, there are three places you can go, is that this wouldn't be acceptable for it to be replaced with other religious texts and be a laughing matter. You do an amazing job of being inclusive and accepting of all cultures, races, and religions. I commend you for this, and myself am trying to be better about it, as I will not claim to be perfect. But had the Holy Bible been replaced with the Quran, I'm sure it would not have been laughed about. I understand that Christianity is most certainly not an oppressed religion, but I would really appreciate it if you claimed to be accepting of all peoples, that you wouldn't treat one religion in a more demeaning manner than the rest. I would like to reiterate what I mentioned first. I really appreciate everything you guys do, but just thought it might be worth addressing. I will certainly not stop listening, as I've been listening for multiple years now. Even hearing my own question being answered in the past was awesome, so I really appreciate that. I know that you're both very thoughtful and intelligent men, so thank you for understanding. Keep rolling them dice. Thanks, Mark.
Oh, thanks, Mark, for this criticism.
Mark, thank you for writing in. I'm sorry if that was felt insensitive to you. Matt and I have both been upfront about our upbringing, and which was religious in one way.
It comes from the fact that, I mean,
yeah,
Rob and I read used to read the Bible every day.
Every
right? Like
day.
This is yeah. our culture or our religion. But yeah, that could be a little insensitive.
So I just want you to know where it comes from, but I certainly don't want anyone to feel hurt or insulted. And genuinely, it's meant lovingly. Like, I actually, that there are many things about the Christian teachings, the Christian faith, theoretically, that I still find very valuable and
absolutely
that I care about. The Bible is a flawed document, not because the faith is flawed or the deity behind it is flawed, but because it was, you know, translated and written by human beings. But I
slow down there, Bart Ehrman, professor of Bible studies.
Really deep cut there, Matt. The point I'm trying to make here is when we joke about this, it's not meant to be I would not make the same joke about the Quran, because I would mean it the same way about the Quran. But I see now how that came off. So
yes.
We'll be more careful and thoughtful in the future. Thank you for making us aware of how that sounded.
I do sort of, yes, and thank you, Mark. Thank you for that criticism. And I do aspire to also be like to reach like the level of Prairie Home Companion, terrible show, terrible person, of like jokes about different Christian denominations, of those sort of loving ribbing between them.
We want our jokes about, we are always going to be a little bit like more, we're going to poke more fun at Christianity than we do at other religions, because that's where we come from. But we want it to be a gentle ribbing. So
yeah, a gentle ribbing, like, you know why Lutherans never roll up paladins or something like that? Or like why Methodists are always, taking wizards or something?
Yeah, why Presbyterians are so always the leaders of the town council. You know, it's just, it's deep cuts about denominational differences. Anyway, so... I can't promise that we're never going to get this wrong again, because when Matt and I are on a roll, this is one of the things we go to. But I don't want anyone to feel... Actually, if someone's insulted by our podcast, I want it to be deliberate. So, you know, I don't want to accidentally hurt somebody's feelings or make fun of something that's important to them. So I'll be more careful about this in the future.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, if someone's insulted, it should be intentional, not unintentional. That's a good point. A credo to live by.
Yeah.
All right, Rob, here's our last letter of the episode. Hey, Matt and Rob, firstly, I want to thank you for providing an amazing left-wing conscientious podcast while also being informative and inspiring. Awesome job. As a bisexual man, it's sometimes hard to find inclusivity within nerd culture, and while I think many among the LGBTQ+ community would agree that it's changing for the better, I still think it's good to thank you for your part in that. With the pandemic getting better and my country of residence getting closer to herd immunity through vaccinations, I've been thinking more about starting up an in-person D&D game again. The pandemic has given me time to build for myself a homebrew world, and I want some of my friends to start exploring it. However, one part of world building that has been somewhat harder for me is planar cosmology. I've always found D&D's generic cosmology to be interesting, but too dependent on alignment. It's part of the game that I think we can agree upon being problematic at best, and Eberron's being too unique for me to steal outright. So my questions are, have you created your own planar cosmologies? If so, where did you come by your inspiration, and would you mind talking about them? If not, do you have any advice for someone who's lost in the infinite planes and trying to bring some order to their thoughts about it? Thanks again for all you do, Kiefer.
This is a great question. We did do an episode on world-building deities, I think, but I don't
but
think
not planes,
not planes, and not cosmologies.
Uh-oh.
Add that to the to-do list, I suppose. This is a great question, and this is I have become fixated on one thing such to the point that my friends now make fun of me about it. But like lately, when thinking about cosmologies, I've been I these days I like draw extremely heavily from Gnosticism and like Jewish mysticism and Kabbalah, and I like to get real weird with it, because I have seen every iteration of here's a group of vaguely humanoid avatar gods, and I am tremendously bored with it, as I am.
If your gods are not burning wheels of eyes.
Right. If your gods are not beyond comprehension, forces. What are you even yep. doing? You know, if from
it's
your...
It's fine to have normal gods, but...
Yes. No, I'm just... To answer Kiefer's question, that's what I do these days. Yeah. That being said, you gave a great example. Eberron has, like, a recognizable planar system and a recognizable, like, pantheon of deities that are interesting and unique.
Yeah, and alignment is not as important, right? Mm-hmm. The big force is, like, the division among the pantheon is, like, pro-creation versus pro-destruction, mm-hmm. Which is not as clear of a line. Eberron, I think, does suffer from the same problem as the other thing, which is fine for a campaign setting for mass publication, which is there are a lot of planes. I think the basic advice to order your thoughts is cut them the fuck down, right? Mm-hmm. Like, do you need 15 planes, right? You're never yeah. going to go to them all unless you're running a plane hopping campaign, planescape style campaign. Cut it down to 4 or 5, right?
Yeah. And you can have a theoretically infinite number of planes for future games, but make a handful accessible, right? Only a handful are relevant, right, to the prime material or whatever your version of that is. You know, don't overwhelm yourself or your players with, yeah, like Matt said, 15,000 planes. That's, you know, that's, I mean, I think, actually, Matt, that's a really good point. The main problem, I think, with most cosmologies of any TTRPG, of any fantasy setting, is they're too complicated. And so my advice would be to do something to make it interesting and differentiate it, but limit the number of overall gods and planes and the structure and framework of your, you know, cosmos, with, you know, the potential to complicate it further later, right? Leave some open ends. But I think the instinct, my advice to any world builder would be to simplify, right? Yeah. Because there's no shortage of incredibly complicated cosmologies out there to draw from.
Yeah. Gnosticism being one of them. Now, if you're looking for something, there's sort of, I think, a second part to this great question, which is there a way to do it without making alignment the primary focus as it is in the Great Wheel? And I would say, like, yes, right? In one of my recent campaigns, the planar cosmology is based off of just different echoes of the real world, sort of a la like a comic book, like multiverse, where it's just a different version of the universe, right? Each plane is like a different multiverse that leans into like one trope, right? This is the sort of... one of like abundant energy and cosmology. This is the one that because you in most Dungeons and Dragons games you still need demons and angels. You know, this is the one where everyone is who lives in the world is an immortal demon and angel. However, like the different planes still follow the same like contours. There's still the same like continents and planets and things like that. So that's one I've done that doesn't lean into alignment, is that the different planes are different echoes of reality that, you know, like the Shadowfell or the Feywild. I just took those two concepts and made more of them.
I like that. Another thing you can do is if you do want to have deities or godlike entities, and I like this, I've seen it in a few settings, is if you still want to have lawful good, neutral, chaotic, whatever, for purposes of your clerics or paladins or whatever, you can have, and one thing I think is very interesting is having gods or deities with motivations and interests and portfolios, but with different aspects, which I think is very interesting. So one god might have both like a lawful good and a chaotic evil aspect, different manifestations of their, you know, their same ethos, kind of like how Batman can be anywhere along the alignment chart, depending on, you know, what iteration it is. I think this could be an interesting way to have a small number of, you know, a small pantheon really like different manifestations. This is also something I've experimented with in some of my world building. I think this is a little bit more interesting than having, this is a lawful good god, this is a neutral good god, this is, you know, a chaotic good god. And, you know, again, Eberron is a better example. The gods are not like perfectly aligned based on their alignment, but I think you can go even further and still have maybe alignment, but the gods or the deities or the cosmos is ordered in a way that doesn't like adhere directly to the 9-box alignment chart.
Right. One source to help you with this is the ideas and published sources of planes that are definitely not of that this is the chaotic neutral plane. Planes like, I already mentioned the Feywild, but like the Far Realm. This is just a plane of mind-boggling, you know, weirdness. Or like in, you know, steal one plane from Eberron. Steal the plane of dreams, right? Mm. This is a plane that people enter when they dream, right? So just get rid of all the alignment planes, and then you've got, oh, this is the elemental chaos plane. This is the Far Realm, the Feywild, the plane of dreams, the plane where everyone is a bug. It's only bug and insects on this plane. Yeah.
And, you know, I think also just this is a bit like what Matt described, but a cosmology where there are no or not necessarily gods at all or deities, and people draw power from various more arbitrary sources, either different planes or ideas or ideals or, you know, overarching cosmological energies. You know, there's a lot of interesting ways to approach this that I think you can break from the mold with. So, great question, Kiefer. I hope that was helpful.
Thanks, Kiefer. Well, Rob, we're not out of letters, but we are out of time.
Unfortunate.
You need to have a time plane.
That's right.
What does that mean? I can't tell you.
The plane. We also need one of those time turners. From the franchise that shall not be mentioned.
Give your players those.
Never. That's a ridiculous idea.
It's a really bad idea.
We will answer more
Everyone's
questions.
Everyone's brain is just hurting at the end of the episode.
We will answer these more questions as soon as we can. Please write us at dmofnone@gmail.com. Add us on Twitter @dmofnone. If you would like to, feel free to subscribe to our Patreon at patreon.com/dungeonmasterofnone.
And if you don't want to, well, that's fine too.
That's okay too. Just listen for free. We'll be back with more things, more talk, more TTRPG news and information. Thanks everybody for listening. Stay healthy, stay safe, and keep rolling them dice.
Dancing on the ash to fly.